Welcome, everybody. Welcome to this new Investor Horizon webinar. We're here today with Willem Bultjes, CEO of Corporate Ventures Advisory, to discuss and help you identify your initial target market, win lead customers, and move beyond pilots. I'm Perrine, Project Manager at the European Business and Innovation Centers Network, the EBN. EBN is a member of Investor Horizon. We are Investor Horizon is a project co-funded by the European Commission and Eureka. We work as a consortium of six partners to deliver an accelerator program with the capacity to host 500 deep tech SMEs until the end of 2021. The program was launched in June 2019, and we have already accelerated for 150 companies across 33 countries. If you're interested in applying to the program, I would like to let you know that the next deadline that is at the end of May, the platform is open for applications and you can check out all the details on our website. You need to be a deep tech company seeking a Series A investment. You have already secured a seed funding and you are based in a new Horizon 2020 country or a Eureka country. If you're interested and you need further information about Investor Horizon, please do check all the details on the website. And we also have monthly sessions to present you the program and the application process. So you can join one of these sessions. The next one is on the 1st of April. You can ask all your questions to the program managers. On Investor Horizon, we do also run these webinars on the monthly basis. The next one is already announced. It will be on the 22nd of April. We will discuss with Paul Weber how to build an optimal venture team to secure funding for the long-term success. You can already register to this session on the website. We do also have a very important and growing community on Eurequity. Please do join the community if you are not in it yet. It's a great opportunity for you to be visible to our network of investors and all our partners. We also have a lot of free of charge online classes about financing and market topics. And I'm coming now straight to our topic of today. I'm very happy to have today Willem Bultjes as a speaker. Willem is founder and CEO of Corporate Ventures Advisory, providing curated matchmaking between global B2B ventures and corporate customers, as well as investors. Willem has been interim investment manager and venture partner at VC Funds. He's also the co-founder of the supply chain sustainability startup Sustainable, and is a very active expert and mentor in several accelerator programs such as Plug and Play or the EIC. So I will give now the floor to Willem to present in about 25 minutes. And you will have time as usual to ask all your questions to our speaker. You can already ask typing in your questions during the presentation. There is a questions window. Please do try to be very clear, very short and concise, so we have time to go through most of the questions until 5 o'clock. So Willem, I would like to give you the floor so you can start sharing your own presentation.
All right, thank you very much, Perrine, for the nice introduction. Let me share my screen here.
Perfect. And this presentation will be sent to everybody after the session, and the session will be also available for replay as from tomorrow. So we see your screen. You can try to start.
All right. then let's get started. Perrin already introduced the topic a little bit and also myself, but let's look a little bit more about my background so you understand also where I'm coming from. I come from the big high-tech industry, 20 years at Philips in Europe and in Silicon Valley. At NXP Semiconductors, I was globally responsible for the sales to the overall automotive industry. At Giesecke Devrient, I was involved in SIM card and credit card, and at Secunet, I was in the board focusing on cybersecurity businesses. So that was my first 30 years of my career, and the next 30 years is working with startups and helping to be them successful. On the right hand, you see a couple of examples of organizations where I'm involved in the Business Angel Network in Germany, other organizations, also Tech Tour, Invest Horizon, of course, as we are here, Copernicus Raw Materials, et cetera, and also on the board of several startups. In the middle, a couple of things that I co-founded myself, Corporate Ventures Advisory, I will get back to on the next slide briefly. Sustainable was mentioned already by Perrin. It's a startup I co-founded in the field of sustainable supply chains. And I'm actually also working on two other startups, which are still in stealth mode, so not public yet, hopefully soon. But let's explain a little bit what Corporate Ventures Advisory is doing. So my current company that I started beginning of last year, just before Corona, with the ambition to help B2B startups from all over the world to get in touch with lead customers. So what you see here on the left side, the corporates, the big corporates, but also smaller companies as customer of ventures, startups, and especially scale-ups. We also do help ventures to get in touch with investors, but the main focus is on the relationship between ventures, startups, and scale-ups, and corporate customers. That's also the topic of today. And why I started that company basically is that I felt that it's more important actually for startups to find paying customers than to get investors. So that's why I want to help them on a global basis. So let's move into the topic immediately. And the first question is, why do you want to have a lead customer? And the obvious answer is to get money. And as I mentioned already, it's sometimes better to get money from paying customers than from investors. And why is that? Because investors only bring you money and a bit of coaching and help, of course. But customers bring you a lot more. They bring you traction in the market, which you can also use to attract investors. And customers, lead customers, also give you a lot of feedback. And that is actually the most valuable about having lead customers. Now, why should they be paying lead customers? If they're not paying, they're not taking you that serious. And of course, it doesn't convince investors if you have potential lead customers, but they are not paying you. So pilot customers, usually in the normal phrasing. So this is a little bit of the summary of why we are talking about this topic today. Finding lead customers to get money, to get traction, and to get feedback on your product or your service. What are you selling to your customer? And of course, I'm spoiling a little bit the question already here because this is not an interactive format, but the question is, what are you selling to your customer? And a lot of people, especially in the deep tech space that we are talking about here primarily, are focusing on a solution. They figured out a great solution. They come from university or from a creative idea or from having a couple of good beers with a good solution. But actually, your customers are not interested as such in a solution. They are interested in solving their problem. So the key, I think, for successful startups is not so much the solution. The solution is not the main problem to be successful in the market. The main problem is to find the actual problem that you are solving and to find the customers that have that problem. So rather than just focusing on technology push, you have to also make sure that you can create a market pool for your solution by identifying the people that have a real problem and that are willing to pay for your solution. So in a nutshell, that's what you are looking for. You are looking for a customer, lead customer that has a burning need. Why does it have to be a burning need and just any kind of problem or need or nice to have? Well, because for a company, especially a bigger company, it's a big risk to actually buy, to purchase a solution from a startup. The startup might go bankrupt. The startup might change their mind. A lot of things can happen. The products are probably not that stable yet. So you have to have a lot of convincing arguments for a company to buy from a early stage or later stage startup. And that means you have to find a really burning problem so that the company, your lead customer, really doesn't know how to solve it otherwise than with your solution. And I had an interesting discussion actually this week. I was coaching in EIT Raw Materials, a company that is developing safety sensors for the mining industry. And I asked the CEO there, so what is the burning problem you're solving? And he showed me a picture that I wanted to share with you here, basically. This is the picture that he showed me of the burning problem in his industry, the mining industry. It's a big truck, as they are usual in the mining industry. Below that, it's actually not a small toy car. It's actually a big Land Cruiser, squashed by the big truck because the big truck driver didn't see the car. Now, that's a pretty big problem. And that is what this company is trying to solve, to prevent those kind of accidents. The other aspect, once you have found actually a burning problem and a customer with a burning problem, the next question is, how much better is your solution versus what they currently use? Because it's an illusion to think that they are not having a solution for their problem yet in most cases, because they are surviving. It's a successful company that you want to do business with. The question is your solution much better than existing solutions? And here you see the difference. The current suppliers and especially established companies are very good at improving their products or reducing the price of their product by about 10% per year. So that's what they can get from their existing suppliers. So to differentiate yourself as a startup from those current suppliers that have a proven track record and everything, you have to be 10 times better. So it's not 10% better, it's 10 times better than their existing solution. Then they are interested in talking to you. Why is that so important? As I mentioned before, it's risky for a company to do business with a startup. And you have to take that into account. You have to think about the total cost of ownership for your customer to do business with you, to try out your product, your solution, and to implement it. The current solution here on the left of this graph is basically known. It's proven. It works. So people are happy with it. So if you come in, basically say, yeah, you have a good working solution, but ours is 10% better, they will say, well, go away. We don't want to waste time on that. We have a proven solution, works. We don't care about the 10% improvement. Because you have to take into account the cost, which is on the right side of this picture, with your solution. The company has to go through a lot of effort and they take a certain risk to actually work with a startup with a technology that is new, that is not proven yet. They have to convince their colleagues, they have to plan implementing your product, they have to install it, they have to do training of the people, they have to do testing, they have to do bug fixing because your product might not work immediately perfectly. So there's a lot of effort and risk involved for a company to do business with a startup in the high-tech field. And you have to realize, you have to be able actually to calculate what kind of effort and risk it is for the company. And that is what we call the total cost of ownership. It's not just the cost that they pay to you, the price that they pay to you for your product or your service. It's everything else, all the effort that the company has to go through to work with you. And that can be even very practical situations, like, for example, the purchasing department of the company is not set up to do business with a startup. They basically say, well, the startup is not listed in our preferred list of suppliers. They don't have a financial solid track record, so we can't do business with them. So the people that want to do business with you in that company have to go through a lot of efforts to convince the purchasing department to make an exception and buy from you as a small startup. The other thing is then to look at, to find out what are your interesting key markets. And again, I had an interesting discussion this week with a company in the sensor for the mining industry field. And we talked about it. So what is the unique aspects of your solution and what are the relevant markets for that? And I had also a couple of years ago, a very interesting example of this. This was a company here in Germany that is making vertical wind turbines. So they turn like this instead of like this. And they didn't really get off the ground. They were not selling very much because the problem with those vertical wind turbines is that they need a lot of wind to be productive. So we helped them actually to find out what markets should they address? What markets should they focus on? Not here in Bavaria where I'm living because there is not a lot of wind, so they should at least be somewhere on the ocean side. But we looked at what are the unique aspects of their solution. So we listed them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And a couple of them were basically a vertical wind turbine needs a very small footprint. So you can put it on a very small location. You don't need a big space. They don't make noise, which is also a big advantage. And they work and survive also in very strong winds. So we started to brainstorm about relevant markets. So which markets don't have a lot of space? So we said, okay, small islands where there are tourists, they don't have a lot of space for big windmills or for solar panels. They don't want to have noise of the big wind turbines. So maybe those small holiday islands might be an interesting target. But of course, that's not a very big market and not a very profitable market. The other one we came up with basically was offshore oil fields, oil platforms and gas platforms that are stationed in the North Sea, for example. Those oil and gas platforms don't have a lot of space, that's clear. So they need a small footprint solution. They need renewable power because the traditional diesel generators are not allowed anymore. And of course, they need to make sure that with big storms on the sea, on the oceans, those wind turbines are still working and not flying off, because that's what they experience with other solutions. So we came up with this kind of table saying, look at your unique aspects, look at the different markets, and then basically select one or two markets that are really leveraging your unique aspects. Once you have done that, the question is, well, how big is that market, of course? And you might say in some cases, well, offshore oil platforms, that's not the biggest market. As I mentioned already, holiday islands is probably also not the biggest market in the world. But then the question is that a problem? And I hear a lot from people, from startups, also startups that get advice to develop their pitch decks, well, you have to address a big market. That might be true, for example, in the software, pure software business and the typical Silicon Valley business, you want to scale up very bigly. Big, but that's not always necessarily the right approach for a deep tech startup. So the question there is, do you want to be a big fish in a small bowl of water, as you see here on the left? Or do you want to be a small fish in the big ocean where you have a lot of sharks waiting to eat you? And my experience and my recommendation is to really not shy away from saying you are a niche player initially. You can always grow to other niches. You can jump into the next bowl of water. But once you are in that big ocean, you have to make sure that you survive and you're not eaten up by all the sharks. And one example of this, for example, is a company here in the Munich area that worked on an electrical motor, which is based on sustainable technology, so not requiring any of the critical earth that you get out of the mines in Africa, for example. So they developed a very interesting e-motor concept. And of course, they were basically initially shooting for the stars, and they wanted to do business with BMW and with Volkswagen, etc., to get into their electrical cars. Now, that was pretty difficult to, first of all, get into those big companies. Because they were not so interested to talk to all those weird startups. But secondly, of course, they then start to realize that before they can really make a revenue out of that, it will take years before their engines are designed into the new electrical cars of BMW or Volkswagen. Before they get a real revenue out of that, it will take years and they can't wait so long. So they decided to change and focus on a different market, namely the outboard motors for motorboats, so electrical motors for motorboats. You might say that's a niche, but it's a pretty big niche. And there they could actually get traction much quicker than in the big traditional automotive industry. And that's what you see here on this picture a little bit. You can shoot, of course, for the big market leader immediately. The value of that deal, if you get a deal with the market leader, of course, is big. And it is great for your presentations, for your PowerPoints, and for your pitch decks, if you can say you are in business with Volkswagen or BMW. But the risk that the deal will not happen in the end, and that you have to spend a lot of time and go through a lot of hoops to actually get a deal with one of those big companies, is also very high. So to play it a bit safer, maybe you don't want to start with the market leader. You want to stay with either a niche player where you can get on the learning curve, or with a growth player that is very eager to become the market leader. A different way of presenting that is actually on this slide, where we see the potential customers that you could address in your market. From the left, you have the market leaders, the number 1, 2, and 3. Then you basically get to the growth players that want to become the number 1, 2, or 3. And then you have a long tail of smaller players. Now, the way to work with those companies is very different for a startup. On the small ones are usually very friendly for you because they are always eager to get some new innovations. They have some time. They have very short decision processes, etc. the big ones, the number one, two, and three, they are risk averse. They are number one, two, or three, and they don't want to run any risk to lose that position. So they are not very interested in taking a big risk and going in bed with a new technology or a startup. The number four, five, and six, they are eager to become the top three. So they might be actually very interested in a good technology that can help them to put the number one, two, or three out of their throne, so to say. And I just had this week also discussion with a company that is providing technology for hydrogen buses, a very hot topic. And the question is, should they go for the Daimlers and the MANs, the big bus producers, to get in there? In the end, we decided no, actually, we go for a lot of those long tail companies. There are a lot of bus coach builders in Europe, many small companies that can never develop the technology for hydrogen buses on their own. So we decided to focus on those ones instead of the big ones first. Over time, that might change, but it might be good to start on the right hand side of this picture. So what do you need basically to search for in a good lead customer for a deep tech startup? You want to have a company that has a burning need, as you see here on the left side. If they don't have a burning need, why should they work with you? Why should they go through the whole effort? You also have to make sure that they're actually willing to take a risk, because of course, for a big company, it is a risk to go in bed with a startup. A lot of things can happen. You have to make sure that they also have lean processes, that they are not going through a process of 6 months to approve you as a supplier for them through the purchasing department, because you can't wait that long. So you have to make sure they have short communication lines, short decision processes. And last but not least, you have to make sure they have an available budget. It doesn't make sense to talk for weeks or for months with a potential lead customer, and then only after months ask, so do you have a budget? And then hear basically from the customer, no, not this year, but we can put it in the budget for next year. That doesn't help you as a startup. So I can only recommend to ask as early as possible in discussions with a potential lead customer, do you already have a budget allocated for this? Or is this something completely new that you have to back the management of the company for budget or wait until the new budget for next year? So in another way of phrasing it, you need somebody, a customer that is eager, that is flexible, and that is forgiving, because things will go wrong with a startup, with a new technology. So if that is not the flexibility that your lead customer has, you will get into trouble, and therefore select the lead customer on those kind of aspects. We had it also actually in another company where I was involved in the field of sustainability management. They were also very much focusing on getting in the big companies like the Volkswagens, etc. And they had very good discussions with the sustainability departments of that organization. And they were very eager to start a project, so very enthusiastic. So the company made a lot of plans, spent a lot of effort on it. And then the question came up, okay, so can we start with a pilot project that is paid? And then, of course, the sustainability department of that company said, sorry, we don't have budget, so we have to ask the management, but probably will be next year. So we lost a lot of time in that company to talk to one of those big customers. And even the department that we talked to was very enthusiastic, but as they didn't have a budget available, nothing came out of it. That was a waste of time for us and also for that company, probably. The other thing you have to think about, where to play in the value chain. And this is just a simplified example of the value chain for mobile phones, basically from the chip design on the left side to the end user of a corporate customer like BASF or whatever at the right hand side. So this is a pretty long value chain. Of course, the real value chain is much more complicated, but you have to decide where to play. If you have a solution for mobile phones, do you sell to the chip manufacturer, to the smartphone maker, to the network operator, or to the enterprise customer? Because you can't go at all the places. You can't go left and right in the value chain. You have to choose where you want to play. And one of the points to do that is to actually understand the value chain and what kind of value chain your business has. Is it on the left-hand side here, front-loaded value chain? So for example, in the gold mining industry, I'll come back to that in a second, or is it on the right-hand side, a back-loaded value chain, which is typically the automotive industry. So you have a few big players like Volkswagen that are selling to the customers, So on the right hand side of this picture here, this bubble, that's Volkswagen, for example, you have a few of those big car OEMs. You have a bit more tier one supplying to the car makers, and then you have a lot of small companies supplying to the tier ones. If you focus on these ones, you have a low risk basically to get a deal. It's pretty likely that you will get one of those, but you only get a small part of the total market. Of course, if you focus on this player here on the right, the car maker, you have, of course, a big market if you get in there. But if you don't get in there, you have nothing. So that's a bit of a risk and reward assessment. On the left-hand side, the typical example here, the historical example, is the gold rush in what is now called Silicon Valley in California, where you had a lot of gold miners here that actually wanted to become rich by finding gold in the nice mountains of California. But actually, the guys who got most money during gold rush, who become really rich, were the suppliers of the shovels and the wheelbarrows and the Levi jeans, because they could supply it to everybody. So they didn't have to worry about which of those are becoming successful. They were successful anyway, because everybody needs shovels and jeans to do gold digging. So that's a very deliberate decision that you have to take. Where do you want to play in that supply chain? How much risk do you want to take? And how much certainty do you want to have to get a decent market share? If you have time, I will skip the next slides, but we can maybe come back to that in the discussion if there are questions about it. Are you a horizontal technology player or a vertical application player? What kind of business models do you have? All important questions, but let's go to a few more things about your storyline to elite customers. What is your value proposition to the customer? And there, it's very important to understand the difference between those three aspects as what I call the value proposition pyramid. There are a few must-haves. So any solution for your customer, for solving the problem of your customer, you have to have. So you don't even have to talk about. It's clear that you have to have. If you are selling a TV like this one from Philips many years ago, of course it has a nice screen and remote control and great sound, etc. You also want to have a differentiator. For example, the pixel resolution is much better than any other TV. But even that's not enough in a lot of cases. You want to have a wow factor that attracts the attention, that brings you into the door with your customer. And in this case, the wow effect is the ambi light, as you see here. So the lights at the back of the TV that basically create this colorful image on the wall behind your TV. That's the wow effect. Nobody really needs that, but it attracts the attention. It says, hey, this is an interesting TV. I want to know more about this. And that's also what you have in the B2B industry. You want to have a wow factor to attract the attention, and then you can focus on the differentiator, what differentiates your solution from all others. But you don't have to waste time on the must-haves. Everybody has those. So in a summary, how to win the deal basically with such a lead customer, you have to have an excellent value proposition. You have to understand the burning problem, the added value or the cost saving that you bring to them. You have to be able to calculate the return on investment, the business case for your customer, not for you, but for your customer. You also have to understand the decision process in the company, who's going to use your solution, who will decide, who will influence, who will block the decision to go with you because they don't like to work with startups or whatever. And does it fit in their existing processes? And last but not least, as I mentioned already, is there a budget available at the customer? And what kind of budget is that replacing? So the budget is limited, but what is the replacing? And does the company want to prefer to pay you in CapEx, so upfront, or in OPEX, in monthly subscription fees? There's a big difference in that, and you have to understand how your target industry is working. And that means also that you have to understand what you're competing with for the money of your customer. It's not necessary for the solution that you're selling, but what is the budget of the customer? Because the budget of the customer is usually limited. So you have their existing solutions that are competing for that money. You have competitors that are competing for the money, but also other interests of the customer competing for that same money. And the customer can only spend it once. So you have to understand what you're competing with, and that is not necessarily a similar technical solution as you have. Finally, the topic of pilot customer or lead customer, at least that's how I use those phrases. A lead customer is a paying customer. A pilot customer, not necessarily in all cases. The mistake that I've seen with a lot of startups, especially in the deep tech space, is that they start a free pilot project with the customer, and they're very happy that the customer is willing to do that. And they start with the pilot project. It might be even a kind of an agreement on the pilot project. And then at the end of the pilot project, the customer is happy, the startup is happy. And then the startup usually expects that it immediately goes on with a real product, a real project, a real paid project. Unfortunately, in many cases, that's not the situation, because after the pilot that might have been for free, there is no budget to do a real project, or the people changed, et cetera, et cetera. So there are a lot of reasons always why customers say, yeah, that was a great pilot. Your solution worked well, but currently we can't turn that into a real business. Maybe next year when we have a new budget, et cetera, et cetera. So it's important to already, when you start with a pilot project with the customer, to try to implement it in such a way that it is already a real project with, for example, recurring revenue plans. But you basically say to the customer, well, the first 3 months or the first 6 months, it's cost free for you until we have proven that it works. But then basically we have the contract already in place to continue with a normal paid project. We can certainly talk about it more in the Q&A, but I wanted to go to the last slide because we're running out over time already. And this is one of my favorite topics. If you are selling to your customer or your lead customer, don't forget that in many cases in the B2B space, at least, your customer is selling to their customer, which might be a consumer or might be another company. And in many cases, it makes a lot of sense to actually talk to the customer of your customer to create a market pool from the customer of the customer towards your customer. So think a little bit out of the box to create the market pool from your customer. If the customer of a tier one in the automotive industry, if Volkswagen, for example, says to their tier one, hey, we have seen a great technology from a startup, you have to build that into the next generation of your products in order for us to buy from you, then of course you have the best chance to get lead customers quickly. So with that, I would like to end. The contact details and things like that can also be communicated afterwards, but let's open up the discussion and the Q&A.
Thank you so much, Willem. I thought it was a really great presentation. You covered already many, many points. Please, everybody, this is the time where you can ask everything you want to Willem, maybe clarify some points that were unclear. So don't hesitate. We have a few minutes. This topic about having pilot customers to pay, it's been a recurrent question there. And we were asked, or you were asked, how to get pilot customers to pay.
Right. As I briefly touched upon already, you might not want to get pilot customers to pay, but you want to make pilot customers real lead customers. And just tell them you don't have to pay for the first month. And there are a couple of advantages of doing that. If you go to a customer and say, we want to do a pilot with you and it's for free, because we're new and we still have to test it, then of course the interest and the credibility of your solution is already a little bit decreased. If you go with a lot of self-confidence, not too much, but with quite some self-confidence to your customer and basically say, we have an interesting solution and we want you to try it out, but we have a standard pricing schedule and we have a standard licensing agreement to use our technology. So if you sign that, we can get started. You don't have to pay for the first 3 months. But after the 3 months, if you like us, you can cancel after 3 months. But if you like what we saw, we just continue with that contract and then it will cost so much per month. So this is an alternative. Maybe it's not directly answering the question how to get money from the pilot customer, but I would say don't think of it as a pilot customer. Think of it as a lead customer that has a pilot phase.
Willem, how a small startup, in a small startup, how can you reach and find the right person in a big organization in the first place? How do you identify the right person?
Very good question. I don't have a specific slide on that, but it relates back to, let's say, where's the slide? A little bit here is about a value proposition. Who has the burning problem and who will use your solution? So you have to figure out who is the ultimate user, who has the burning problem in that organization. So if you say, I have an interesting solution for the automotive industry, but don't try to call the central number of BMW, but figure out which department would be interested in having your solution. Now, then the next question is, of course, how do you get a contact with the person? And one of the approaches is, in the meantime, I think very effective, is through LinkedIn. Just search on LinkedIn for people that are working in the right department and try to get in touch with them. Normally, of course, you could say there are a lot of conferences to go to, but not in Corona time. So LinkedIn, I think, is a good way, or basically ask us to help you, because that's exactly what we are doing with Corporate Ventures Advisory. I don't want to make advertisement for that, but that's exactly what we do through networks. And that is what you have to build up yourself as well. You have to find people that are coming from the industry you want to target, and ask them to make warm introductions to people, because cold calling is not really a good solution if you are in a deep tech business.
Thanks. Processes in big companies are very slow. Is there a good strategy to speed it up?
It is very much related to this question of how big are the players that you want to focus on. Especially the big companies are usually very slow because they have very established processes. Smaller companies, or for example, family-owned companies, so Mittelstand here in Germany, they are usually much quicker in their decisions because there is the founder of the company, the owner of the company, and with a bit of luck, you can get directly to them. So I think the first answer to your question is not how to speed up the process, but is to select the right lead customer that has shorter processes. Because you can't change the processes in a Volkswagen, for example. You can, of course, find again the person in the company that has a burning problem, that is your champion, and you can use that champion, you can help the champion actually to develop the processes internally and the sense of urgency in the company to do a deal with you, but still it will be slow. So focus on the companies that can make quick decisions initially, because otherwise you're wasting your time, and time is very expensive for a startup.
Thank you, Willem. To the audience, there are a lot of questions. Please be very short, so otherwise I don't have time to go through the questions. Another question, could you elaborate on customer-funded business versus fundraising with VCs?
I like that question because that was my first point, I think. Of course, you need both in many cases. And it very much depends on your business model and how long you need to develop a certain technology. If you develop a new battery technology, you probably will need a lot of money from investors to go through a long period before you can make business going. But even then, you can try to get projects co-financed by customers, by lead customers. You can actually talk to a lead customer, say, hey, if you want to be the first one to use this technology, to test this technology in your business, let's work together. Maybe talk a little bit carefully about exclusivity for a certain period of time, but basically say, if you want to be the first one, if you want to have the best insight in this new innovative technology, you have to pay a little bit of project money to us. So it's not just that you have to get the cash for the ultimate product, you can also get cash earlier sometimes from the customers. And as I mentioned, the customer will get you a lot more than just the money. They will get you, they also might give you actually some support in kind. They can provide you with measurement equipment or test facilities, or maybe they can help you with purchasing components, et cetera, et cetera. So think about how to create a win-win for the lead customer and yourself. I'm not sure that answers the question, but hopefully it helps a bit.
Willem, could you explain the slide with the variety of software alternatives, licensing, subscriptions?
Right. That was the slide I quickly skipped through. So thanks for asking. Then we can come back to that. Yeah, so this is one of my favorite topics also in terms of deep tech. So think about your business model. What is the business model if you are developing a new technology? You can basically say, well, we develop a new technology and we license it to everybody that wants to use it. That's here at the bottom of the slide. That's a good strategy, and actually it means you don't need a lot of money because you don't have to build products and you don't have to build a big sales organization. You can license the technology to others. But it's not so easy to license technology. It also takes time. So that's one of the models. You can also, of course, say based on the technology that we developed, we build the hardware ourselves. So we sell the hardware products, or we build software and we license the software to others, or we basically do an online service, which is also effectively licensing, or at the top here, basically you do a kind of anything as a service. So basically you provide a total solution for a recurring fee, for a usage fee, et cetera, et cetera. Now, those are all, and of course there are more business models, but those are all different models that you have to think about before you start to talk to customers, preferably. Now you can change it over time, but you have to basically understand what play you want to have ultimately, because that also determines where in the value chain do you want to play. So if you are technology licensing, you can actually license your technology, for example, to the chip maker for the mobile phone industry. If you want to develop a great application or an AI application or a voice recognition application, you do software licensing. You might license it to the cell phone maker, or you might license it to the telco operator, or even to the end user. So depending on your business model, you have to focus on different parts of the value chain.
Thanks, Willem. How would you find lead customers in very fractioned industry like healthcare, hospitals?
Also good question. So I think it's a bit related to this question. If I interpret the question right, so you have a lot of hospitals, and the question is, how many hospitals can you go to and try to sell to? Probably not too many. And also investors will ask, what is your sales strategy? How do you want to cover all the hundreds of hospitals only in Germany and thousands in Europe? So there the question is, who is supplying to the hospitals where you can actually sell to? So there might be distributors that distribute special medical equipment to hospitals. So you can focus on a few of those. Or maybe there is even more consolidation, but look also in the supply chain. If the hospital is your end customer, it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to directly go to the hospital. Yes, you have to do that probably for the first few projects, because you have to talk directly to a hospital. But in terms of your sales strategy, you can also talk about the suppliers to the hospitals. The same was in the automotive industry.
Thanks, Willem. Do you think that it helps to use the pilot as the way towards investors funding? And if yes, is it better to be paid pilots instead of non-paid ones?
Also a good question. I would say in general, if it's a non-paid pilot and it is a pilot, most investors say that doesn't count. Because there is no commitment from the customer, there is no commitment that the customer is really liking what you do, because they are not paying for it, and there is no guarantee that they will continue after the pilot. So you have to see it basically as a proof of concept. I think a pilot is a proof of concept. It's not necessarily yet a proof of market. It's only a proof of market if you have customers that are paying and they actually subscribe, for example, for a solution for the next year or so.
How do I go from a niche market to a broader market?
Right, very good question also. The issue is do you go to another niche? So do you jump from one fishbowl to the next fishbowl, as I always say it, which is a very good strategy. Or basically, do you grow from the fishbowl into the ocean? Now, it very much depends on your product. And let me go to one slide that they also skipped. Also, one of my favorite, it's a very boring slide, but it's a very relevant topic, I think, for a lot of the audience here. Are you doing a horizontal play or a vertical play? So if you have a technology that can be used for a lot of different applications in healthcare, in automotive, et cetera, for example, a sensor technology, you can't address all those applications as a small startup. So you have to choose either we are just licensing the sensor technology, or you say, we focus on a niche first. We focus first on a very specific application in healthcare, a vertical application. Once we have covered that, we actually start the next vertical application, which might be the same sensor technology, but now used in a very specific area for electrical bikes or whatever. So you can jump from vertical niche to vertical niche based on your underlying technology. That's one of the approaches. But it, as I said, it depends very much on what the core of your business is.
Okay, we have also a question for a mobile application, a software. Is it crucial for success to get initial customer traction on B2C before going to B2B?
Not necessarily. also that depends very much on what kind of application it is. If it is a kind of a gaming application, then yes, I think you have to get traction in the consumer market through guerrilla marketing or whatever approach you can do. But if it's more a, for example, healthcare application or a fitness application, then I think it's possible to find partners. And for example, in this space, just as an example, I've worked with a lot of startups in also startups in the field of fitness applications or water leakage applications in your house, etc., etc. There's a very good way to work actually with the insurance company, for example, because the insurance companies are very eager to get more contact with their customers, because normally insurance companies have only once a year contact with their customer when the new bill has to be paid, or when the customer dies when they have life insurance. So the insurance companies are very interested in those kind of applications that give them more regular contact with their customer. So an insurance company, if for example through your application you can increase the fitness and therefore reduce the health cost of the users, an insurance company can be an interesting partner for you.
There is a question. How do I convince an investor regarding my sales funnel? How do I succeed getting letters of interest?
Good question.
Enough to convince an investor.
Right. I think to do that, you have to convince the investor that you have enough customers that have a burning need, that are willing to pay for your solution. So a simple letter of interest or letter of intent might not even be enough. It has to be a bit clearer. So I think it's a combination of the different things you have normally in a sales funnel. You have people that are interested. You have people where you're negotiating a deal, and you have people that have already signed a deal. And you have to have, in all those three categories, you have to have a certain pipeline, and you have to show that the pipeline is going up. And I think that's one of the most important things for a lot of investors, that they see that actually it's going up. So if you just say we have 5 paying customers, that's not so interesting. If you say, well, 3 months ago we had 5 paying customers and now we have 10 paying customers, that's an interesting factor. It's about the trend. Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have also a question. What are your advices for the sales strategy with B2C clients?
I'm a bit less involved in B2C, but I started my career in B2C in Philips Consumer Electronics and Philips Media. I think in the B2C space, you have to be extremely creative, I would say. I use the word guerrilla marketing. It's maybe an outdated term by now, but I think it's still valid. You have to find a really creative way to get to your customers, because it doesn't make any sense, I think, for a startup to do that through massive advertisement campaigns and things like that. So you have to find a way to really get a buzz in the industry, mouth-to-mouth advertisement, which is now done by social media. So you have to find a group of people, a specific target segment, where people are very interested in talking amongst each other about your application. You have to make it, first of all, you have to make it sticky, but also you have to make it viral, which is not a good word in the times of Corona, but you have to make it viral so that basically your customers will promote it for you, because you can't afford marketing budgets.
Okay, Cecil is correcting me. It was not B2C, but B2G.
Ah, B2B, yeah, B2G is indeed, it's only very small. On the screen, it's very small to see. Yeah, no, that's a really good question.
It has also a good input.
B2G is even more difficult, I would say, as B2C or B2B, because governments are. Well, it depends on the country that you're in. Probably, if you're in Estland, I guess it's pretty quick. But if you're in Germany, it's very slow. So most government organizations are very slow, and they have always big problems with budget. So if you want to sell to a government organization, it's even more important to understand what budgets are available for what you want to do, and when are they available, and when are the decisions being made about those budgets. Because otherwise you will waste your time for a long time. So focus on finding out who is the budget owner, what budget is available, how to get access to that budget before you start talking to them.
Okay, very good tips. So I think we covered everything. Do you have, okay, we have another question. in healthcare sales cycles, healthcare sales cycles are very long. What recommendations do you have? And will be the last question, I think.
Healthcare, they're long in automotive. They're even longer, maybe, I would say. One question is, again, can you find another application that doesn't require such a long lifetime? Now, in healthcare, depending, again, what you're doing in healthcare, but can you think about a fitness application that you can sell directly to consumers, for example, or to fitness centers when they open again after Corona? So can you find another route for your product which is not directly addressed to that? Now, let me give you one example of that, which is worked the other way around, actually, but it might be inspiration if you still have, we still have a few minutes. Yeah. I was coaching 1.5 years ago a startup that developed a cleaning solution, a dry cleaning solution for fitness centers. So a small locker box where you can put in your clothing after fitness, even your shoes, and you switch it on, and the next day when you get to the fitness center again, they smell fresh, they are not crinkled anymore, even your shoes smell fresh, et cetera, et cetera. Great solution. Now, what happened, of course, they were just launching that and starting to sell that to fitness centers when Corona came. So they couldn't sell, fitness centers all closed, and a lot of them are not doing very well or going bankrupt. So they thought about what can we do? And of course, they realized, well, our technology, which is based on UV light, can also kill bacteria and viruses. That's why they are cleaning, actually. They kill the bacteria, which normally are creating the smell, but they also kill viruses. So they started to figure out, can we also kill coronaviruses with this solution? And they proved that, and they switched basically the model, and they are now selling, actually very successfully, to hospitals, a solution that was originally designed for fitness centers. Now, of course, once that is done and once everything is getting settled, they hopefully still will have a business in the hospital market, but they also will go back to the original market, which is the fitness market. So this is just an example, maybe a bit in a different direction as the question, but it's about asking yourself, based on your unique technology and your unique solution, can you find another market where this might be useful, where you can actually get quicker into the market than in the long cycles like in the hospital business.
Thank you, Willem, and thank you everybody for we are now concluding this session. I hope you liked it. As usual, I'd like to ask you all to give us a bit of feedback after the session. It takes just a few seconds. Next session, 22nd of April, also a great speaker. Thank you so much for being so many attending each time, and the session will be available for replay tomorrow on our YouTube platform. I wish you all a very nice afternoon, and see you soon. Bye.